Good morning. Oh, come on, y'all can do better. How y'all doing? So welcome to St. Peter's. If this is your first time here or your first time back in a while, the thing we say is welcome home. Everything that you need for the service is here in your worship leaflet or in the hymnal in the pew rack in front of you, that blue book. Everyone is welcome here, and we are honored to welcome our bishop, Bishop Stokes, here today. This is his last formal visitation with us, though he will be back for another party in February when we ordain Reverend Liz to the priesthood. In any event, it is such a blessing to be gathered here today. So I just want to make sure you have what you need. Everything is good. You may have thought you were just going to come and support the families and just sort of sit in the back and be quiet. We don't roll like that. So if you hear a Lord be with you, then you chime in back in with it, and also with you. And wherever the bishop takes us, we're going in worship of our most loving God today. Such an honor to be here. We'll start shortly. I just wanted to give you all a welcome and let you know that you will be singing as we enter into worship today. God's peace.
Good morning. Please stand and let's, as you're able.
Holy Spirit, send to St. Peter's all who.
Thank you.
Of all have need and them drowns. It's all make my thing. Must thy mind eternity crown him. Triumph. come toward the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring and lives.
And if you would stay up here with us this time.
Over God hath reigned, who once on earth incarnate were, for ransom sinners slain, now reigns in realms of light, where saints are.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God for all of
us. One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God, Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who wishes to restore all things in your well-beloved Son, that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his gracious rule, who lives and reigns and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings. Thank you. Oh, yeah.
A reading from the book of Jeremiah. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people. It is you who have scattered my flock away, and you have not attended to them. I will attend to you, for you are evil. For your evil doings, says the Lord, then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord. this morning is Psalm 46. We will read responsibly by verse. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Through its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble at its tumult, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. The nations make much ado, and the kingdoms are shaken. God has spoken, and the earth shall melt away. Come now and look upon the works of the Lord. What awesome things he has done on earth. Be still then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The second reading is a reading from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision, by those who are called the circumcision, a physical. I apologize. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption for the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creations. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions, or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him, God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross, the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The Gospel of the Lord.
Chef's hat. I like that. That's like a chef's coat. Well, like what? Like a paper boat. Yeah. You could do that, right? Jail, right? So, yeah. So, do you know what this hat's shape is? Is it to you? Anyone? He does, but he's not laughing. The hat that bishops wear, and some are bigger, but they're intended to remind you of the flames of Pentecost. That came down on the disciples on the Feast of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit came like tongues of flame, alighting on the disciples' heads, filling them with the Holy Spirit, came with a rush of wind, whoosh, going down. That's the beginning of God living inside and being stirred up inside all the matter. Pretty cool, huh? And this. This, what's this remind you of? Right? A shepherd's thing. It looks like what? Like Bo Peep's cane.
Yeah, I like that.
I'm always proud of that. Yeah, I told you that back in there. leads over the water. You know what happens? You know why it's shaped this way? So if you start to wander, So at any rate, and a bishop also comes from a word that means has oversight. The bishop has oversight. So for those who's visiting today for the first time, welcome. We're glad you're here. Diocese of New Jersey area, and the Diocese of New Jersey has 135 congregations, 145 from Elizabeth to Cape May. And I have oversight of all of this, so I need to bring everybody here. But I wonder if there's a future bishop here. What do you think? And we're going to elect a bishop January 28th, my successor on January 28th. I think you guys might be a little young for this program.
Maybe the next week.
You might be a bishop.
For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and him was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross, and in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. It's a joy to be back at Spotswood. And what a great day to be with you all. Church, we don't see that all the time. Isn't that great, everybody? Yeah, we can do that. Thanks, Peter. I'm going to start out with some thank yous. Are the wardens here, wardens and vestry? Any vestry? Stand up, wardens and vestry. Let's acknowledge them. Let's see. I have, in every visitation I've been making in the last couple of years, as I go into churches, I've been saying a profound thank you to you lay leaders. And to all the people of God, really, because it's taken us.
But, you know, one of the things
that I recognize is that it is not easy sustaining and maintaining a church. And this is a complicated place. You've got a historic property. Old. I mean, there are just lots of challenges.
And
yet here we are. And it's really the investry know what was in to keeping this
active,
proclaiming the mission and ministry of Jesus Christ week in and week out, this time in this place. And for that, I give you thanks.
It is never easy doing that work.
It's especially been difficult in the years of COVID. And you have done remarkably well. There is great life and vitality at St. Yeah, amen. Let's do that. Okay. Thank you all. I'm really grateful to the rector of this congregation, Marshall Shelley, who's been here since 2010, served as Dean of the Northern Convocation. The deans of the convocations are a division within the Diocese of Regions, and Northern Convocation has about a dozen congregations that The deans helped me administer, but also serve as counselors and advisors to the bishop. He served in that role faithfully and well. I'm always grateful to have had him as an advisor and counselor. He's been from before the time I came into the diocese, and then when he came in, he began to work with him and be a leader. He did amazing work chairing a committee, a task force during COVID that really was what we call the vaccines and the testing and vaccine. Congregation, and especially in urban settings and communities of color, where there was sometimes reticence about that. And he was instrumental with his team of making sure that people were safe and kept safe and had the resources to be safe during COVID. So again, I'd like to acknowledge Marcus. And where's Laura? Is she here? There she is. Hi, Laura. Acknowledge ministry, Laura, behind the scenes, altar guild, so much. Amen. Thank you for that. I also want to welcome Deacon Liz Marshall from the Diocese of Massachusetts. We have been blessed to receive you from that diocese. And as Father Marshall mentioned, I'll be ordaining Liz to the priesthood on behalf of Bishop Alan Gates sometime, February 11th, the date is set, knock on wood, and all goes well, right? So that's just great. I also want to acknowledge Kirk Bonamici, who I know he and Laura have relocated, but he served as treasurer of the diocese for many years, and I'm deeply grateful for all he did for us. And I know Laura was so active in this church. And again, it takes so many people to lead the church. We have baptisms and confirmations. Welcome. We're so glad you're here. What's the baby's name again? Malaya. I'm looking forward to baptizing Malaya. We're going to. And she's I better not press my luck, right? Move on, Bishop, right? Yeah. So, and confirmations. It's just great to see all of you to be confirmed this morning. I got a chance to meet you a little bit, most of you in the back. You clean up really well. The boys told me, I said, how many? First time, maybe, but you look really. And I'm going to be glad to do that. Let me ask you, what's confirmation? And the crazy, because they know you know it. Yeah, go ahead. It's for older kids. We're getting there. That's pretty good. What's What's it about? It's all about, right? Confirmation is all about, say it with me, baptism. If we don't get anything else today right, we're going to get that right. Confirmation, you guys are going to make a commitment to the baptismal promises that we're all going to commit ourselves to today, all of us, but you're taking those on as your own. Because up until this point, others made those promises on your behalf. Who? Parents and godparents. Parents and godparents, raise your hands. Look around, folks. Give them a hand. Yay. I really want to mark this moment because we are here doing this because that group of people kept a promise. You hear me? And especially in our culture today, this is countercultural. Kids just don't go to church the way they went to. Kids don't take the discipline of being prepared for confirmation the way they used to. So we're sitting here with how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. With 12 kids this morning, that is exceptional. Isn't that? So I want to see, amen. So I want to say that, I want to say thank you to parents and godparents because you kept a promise. And it is an important promise. You have given them the gift of their story. the story through which they should be looking at the world, through which they'll interpret the world. And I'm going to say more about that. John Calvin used to refer to the Holy Scriptures as the through which the faith. I would push that out a little bit and say this Christian faith of ours are the spectacles through which we look at and interpret the world. Now, you all, do you remember the promises you made? You will with God's help. Remember them. Yeah, yeah, no, it's true. And live them. And live them, right? But all of them, when we make that you need help with. Don't you remember? For sure. That's all right. It's okay. He took the one you had, which is, listen, you're going to take one. Love your neighbor. That's the one you should grab. There. Let me go to more here. This morning, we are observing the feast of the King, which I think is a great time and an appropriate time for us to think about our priorities and loyalties. Who or what holds ultimate sway in our lives? What alternative claims are made on us? What assertions take hold of our hearts? Are these other claims, values, concepts, and consistent with our identity and commitment to followers of Jesus Christ, to which today, do the latter values that the world wants to claim, consumerism, materialism, all kinds of things, do these latter values ennoble or degrade us? These are the questions behind this feast day. What do you know about the establishment of the Feast of Christ the King? Anyone know anything about that? Here we are. It's the Feast of Christ the King. You're not sir? He's because he was here earlier and heard my answer. I bet he knew it before that, too, though. You know what the origins of this Feast of Christ the King are? I'm going to tell you. In 1922, the Black Church marched on Rome. Italy's economy had been suffering. The government had been a mess. Mussolini made the trains run on time. In 1922, Adolf Hitler became the unchallenged leader of the Nazi Party. And later, he and his followers attempted to take control of the German government with their infamous Beerhaus Putsch. That failed. Time to write Mein Kampf. A decade later, he would be successful in taking over Germany and begin a dialogue with the parents who are familiar. Following the death of Vladimir Lenin in 1924, have you heard me now? 22, 23, 24. Following the death of Vladimir Lenin in 1924, Joseph Stalin quickly began to consolidate his power and would soon control Russia as a brutal dictator. It was within this historical context, these events, a context that witnessed the fall of royal houses across Europe, as well as the Ottoman Empire, and which was witnessing the rise of fascism, Nazism, and Marxism, with the concurrent rise of brutal ideological dictators, all anti-religious, all anti-clerical, that Pope Pius XI established the Feast of Christ the King, with the publication of the encyclical Quas Primas, signed on December 11th, 1925. The encyclical and his kingdom. Perhaps it's difficult for us as Americans to identify with this Feast of Christ the King. After all, we have very little experience with kings and kingship, and I expect little desire to find out what they're about. We actually fought a war about that, right? We are a nation forged on democratic values with all of the imperfections that we've had throughout our history, and the freedom of the individual, which has been hard won for some groups. This is vitally important contribution we've made to the world, and we're still working at it. Still, as many have observed, democracy is fragile. Today, some believe democracy is even under threat. Freedom is being sold out. All kinds of market forces, nationalist forces, even so-called Christian nationalist forces, vie for our allegiance, insinuate themselves into our lives and politics, becoming increasingly more daring and corrupting as they attempt to accomplish their ends. How does this relate to the Feast of Christ the King? Well, the key question for each of us to ask is, what is the nature of the Christ in whom we believe? The Christ who we proclaim as King? What is the nature of the kingdom to which he calls us? Is it the love of power? Or is it the power of love? Is it the love of power or the power of love? Yep. Go ahead, tell me. Amen. Give her a hand. The power of love.
Gospel reading for today is from the Passion Gospel. Is it interesting that those who compiled our dictionary chose this particular reading for the Feast of Christ the King?
Think about that. What does this say about this king in whom we believe? The one whom the writer of Colossians is the very image of the invisible God, the one in whom the fullness of God is pleased to dwell. If you want to know what this God is like, the writer of Luke and Colossians is saying, look at the cross. He's on the cross, seemingly powerless. And yet, this humiliated, seemingly powerless king asserts both his authority and the power of his love to one of the two thieves hanging there with him, assured him that that very day he would be with his king in paradise. And of course, the passion, the cross, Christ's humiliation and death are not the final word on this king or his kingdom. Easter is. Easter and the resurrection. And when all is said and done, Easter and the resurrection are about the nature and reach of God's love. Ask you, who has the ultimate power in this account? God is love, we say. That is the nature, essence of this God in whom we believe. Love is also the same God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God is love. God loves action. Moreover, God calls each of us, each and every one of us, to love. A new commandment. You have to be commanded to love sometimes. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. So I have to say, for me, Christ in his kingship is love.
I'm willing to proclaim that Christ
in that kingship any. And I hope you are too. You know, this work is hard work. Did you know that? You know, we've been told a lie.
We've been told a lie.
Love is this kind of a feeling
floating around.
And you catch it, right?
You fall into it.
Or out of it, right?
So it doesn't
require any work of our part at all. Wrong. Length of time. You with me? Susan, I've been married 46
years. I require work.
There are those times when the promise, the covenant,
and the will
to love gets you. We've raised four kids.
Same
deal. Sometimes it is the commitment of love that gets you through. Richard Rolle, the English mystic, once said, loyal and true love acts in this way, as an act of human will.
Love is a
grace and a gift of God, free, and we all have it. God's given it to us all. It's been given to us as a blessing from the moment we come into this world. But once given, we need to be stewards of the gift. We need to be stewards of the gift of love and use it and use it richly and abundantly, because it's one of those things, the more you use it, the more it develops. Amazing. Each and every day, and the baptismal covenants about to make are about how to live the way of love. You know, they're about the love of God. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. It's not just about up here, right? I believe, oh yeah, I thought about that. It's about here. I believe in you. We believe in this God who has revealed himself to Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Like we believe in those most dear to us. And God believes in us. What I call the lifestyle clauses. Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers? Will you resisting evil? And when you fall into sin, repent, return to the Lord. We all do. And Paul writes, all have sinned, all fall short of the glory of God. Every one of us, bishop, priest, deacon, layperson, we fall short. We need to turn around, return to God. And the God we love comes running out like that father figure in the, somewhere I read that. Yeah, that's the one. Luke's Gospel, chapter 15. Runs and braces, brings the son back into the fold. Will you persevere in resisting evil? When have you fallen into sin? Will you proclaim word and example? Not word, word and example, the good news of God in Christ. Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons? Act like you, who think like you, all person, loving your neighbor as yourself. And will you strive for justice and peace among all people, the dignity of every human being? It would be great if we can do that. What do you think? Well, friends, that's what God, yeah, amen. Calls us to, and it's hard work, because sometimes people aren't lovable. Day, we have to ask ourselves, to whom do we belong? Who is our song? Who is our true king?
Most sacred and most dear.
And how will we act on these beliefs and values? These are the questions of this day.
Feast of Christ King.
As we Advent, coming anew of Christ King into our world and into our lives. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting
God, whose will it is to restore all things in your well beloved Son,
the King of kings and Lord of lords,
mercifully grant the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be
freed and brought together under his most gracious
and loving kingdom,
who lives and reigns with you and the Holy
Spirit, one God,
now and forever. Could you get me a water bottle, please? Thank you. Oh, great, good. I'll hold that for you. The candidates for holy baptism will now be presented. And to the parents and godparents, will you be responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life? Will you, by your prayers and witness, help this child to grow into the full stature of Christ? Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love? Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord? The other candidates will now be presented.
I present these persons for confirmation, reception, and reaffirmation of their baptismal covenants.
And to the candidates, Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil? Oh, no, evil's not going away with that. No. We're renouncing evil. I mean, there's real evil in this world, right? And this is to you all. That's what this is all about. So let's try one more time, please. Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil?
I do.
One more time, just one more. Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil?
I do.
Excellent. And do you renew your commitment to Jesus Christ? You guys need a script there, because there's more of a line there. There we go. It's always helpful to have the script. Do you renew your commitment to Jesus Christ? Excellent. And to the congregation present, will you who witnessed these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ?
We will.
Then let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord? Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for these people who are to receive the sacrament of new birth and for those who have renewed their commitment to Christ. Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open their hearts to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill them with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send them into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring them to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer. Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Great.
Any children would like to come forward to watch the baptism from the
separate room? Can I ask you to hold the book? That'd be great. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Yeah, children, come on up if you want to. Anyone? Okay. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your son, Jesus, received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who hear are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever.
Amen.
Malia, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
There we go.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by the Holy Spirit you've bestowed upon this your servant the forgiveness of sin and have raised her to a new life of grace. Sustain her, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give her an inquiring and discerning heart and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works.
Amen.
Your spirit in baptism. Christ forever.
Amen.
Let us welcome the newly baptized. We receive into the house of God resurrection and share with us his outstanding. Great.
Give her a round.
Yeah, let's do that. Let us now pray for these persons. Christ. Almighty God, we thank you that by the death and resurrection of your Son, you overcome sin and brought us to yourself. You've bound us to your service. Renew in these your servants the covenant you made with them at their baptism. Send them forth in the power of that Spirit to perform the service you set before them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And I'm just doing standing. Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Dorothy with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life. Amen. God bless you. Okay, there you go. Congregation may be seated.
Lori.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Doreen with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life. Amen. God bless you. Reception. Take your right hand, Keith. Keith, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you. Welcome. God bless you.
Anthony. And Donna.
Great. Take your ring. Anthony, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. And we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you. Welcome. Here you go. Donna, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. And we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you.
Confirmation. Haley, she's my first baptism.
Haley was Father Marshall's first baptism at St. Peter's. How's that for the cycle? Very good. Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Haley with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life. Amen. Amen.
Lex. Alexander, confirmation.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Alexander with your Holy Spirit. Empower him for your service and sustain him all the days of his life. Amen.
Bless you. Congratulations. Rory, confirmation.
Finally, right? After all these years. Right? Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Rory with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life. Amen. God bless you. Here we go.
Danny Lauren.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Daniel with your Holy Spirit. Empower him for your service and sustain him all the days of his life. Amen.
Morgan.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Morgan with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life. Amen.
Isabella.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Isabella with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life.
Amen. Thank you, Isabella. Andrew Quigley, confirmation.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Andrew with your Holy Spirit. Empower him for your service and sustain him all the days of his life.
Amen. Amen. Reagan.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Reagan with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life.
Amen. Alexander Shaw, Alex. Confirmation.
That's the sound of Bethlehem. Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Alexander with your Holy Spirit. Empower him for your service and sustain him all the days of his life.
Anna.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Anna with your Holy Spirit. Empower her for your service and sustain her all the days of her life.
Amen. Aiden.
Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Aiden with your Holy Spirit. Empower him for your service and sustain him all the days of his life. Strengthen, O Lord, your servant Daniel with your Holy Spirit. Empower him for your service and sustain him all the days of his life. Almighty and ever-living God, let your fatherly hand ever be over these your servants. Let your Holy Spirit ever be with them and so lead them in the knowledge and obedience of your word, that they may serve you in this life and dwell with you in the life to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let's acknowledge again the Spirit's movement in the lives of those confirmed and received today. God bless you. And in the baptismal family, please stand as you're able. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Amen.
peace, Lord. Peace, the Lord be with you. All right.
Good morning. Please see the first thing that I have. One of the things that the rector is always reminded of here at St. Peter's is high enough. I'll hear it. So,
yeah, amen.
I'm so glad that she decided to tolerate autism. That's a good couple of announcements, but first and foremost, to extend the warmest welcomes to the entire St. Peter's family,
all those who are here for the first time, or those who are
not for the first time in a while. It's such a blessing to be gathered
as the whole body of
Christ, the whole church, celebrate those who are making their commitment
to Christ, and those
welcome our bishop, Bishop Stokes. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
You can give him a round of applause, please.
Thank you.
I was having lunch for him a couple of weeks ago, and I said, and I'm sure every priest says this, but you're like, you know, if you want to come and just be here at the 8 o'clock, that's great too. He's like, so he's been here all morning. So, you know, just give him full credit. He's got a very busy schedule. He did an ordination yesterday. I'm sure he got something this afternoon. It's hard press, especially in these months as he prepares for his retirement. He and Susan are moving to Florida. The fact that he's making this kind of time for us here at St. Peter's is a real blessing, and the opportunity to gather and celebrate with him this life in Christ that we share. So thank you, Bishop, for being here.
Thanks for the
truly
invitation.
A great.
Thank you.
In fact, he loves us so much, he's going to be back in February for Reverend Liz's ordination. Those of you who don't know this, Reverend Liz is actually going through the process in the Diocese of Massachusetts, and she received her final approvals from that standing committee. And on behalf of Bishop Gates of Massachusetts, Bishop Stokes will be ordaining her to the priesthood on February 11th. That is the feast of the Empress Theodora. I love that. Hi, Marks. We're really excited about this. She is the second woman to be ordained here at St. Peter's in over 260 years. So, and given the fact that it was only the girls who wanted to put on the mitre and hold the crochet practice. So let us give thanks for those gifts being celebrated. There will be a closing of the office on Wednesday and Thursday for the Thanksgiving holiday. If you have any pastoral emergencies, please just give me a call on my cell phone. Please be aware that our administrator, Chris, is in and out of the office. She is still tending to her husband as he recovers from kidney transplant surgery. Thank you so much for the prayers and the support that you have given to her. I'm speaking on her behalf and on her husband, Chris's behalf. Such a blessing. I got to see a picture of the kidney that was donated. And I know it sounds weird, but such a grace-filled thing. And I just want to stress to you that we are advocates in this parish of organ donation and of transplant support. So please do be in mind of that. We have people who received hearts, received kidneys. It is such a blessing to be able to tender that gift. So if you are discerning a possible call to being an organ donor, please consider that you are able to give the gift of life to others, and we celebrate that. So God bless Chris and his healing journey, and to be sustained in that path. I also want to give a huge shout out to our Sunday school and to our adult inquirers. These guys have worked so hard over the past couple months, but it's also been a blessing to walk with them throughout their young lives as they have grown and matured in the wisdom and knowledge of the Lord. And truly, I have to say to you that these
are the most prepared, most focused, most aware group of confirmands I've raised up in a while. We're so blessed to have them here, and you've set a great example for all of us in the call we have to share in the life of Christ. There's so much going on in the life of Christ. I'll enjoin you to look at the website at St. Peter's. Please do check it out. We are so blessed to be able to gather here in the light of God's love. Bienvenidos a San Pedro, and we are glad you are here. Welcome home, and for this pueblo, for this comunidad, we are so honored to have you here. Please know that everyone is welcome to receive communion at St. Peter's. Y'all don't have to be an Episcopalian or a member of St. Peter's to come up and enjoy the feast that we are being invited to, particularly as Malia is not quite on solid food yet. Y'all have a cookie on her behalf. Please be aware. The bread from your hands into the wine and place it on your cup. Please extend that. If they contact your lip, return to the fray. Silver chalice is for sipping, silver sipping. You got the line up there? Okay, just checking. Some people don't. They walk up and they're like, what do I do with this? Well, you eat it, then take a sip. If it's silver, the action of the silver and the wiping of the purificator and the wine itself is sanitizing. It is not sterilizing and sanitizing, but it is safe to imbibe in either fashion. And know that you are most welcome. If you're not comfortable receiving communion here, that is fine too. Simply come forward and the bishop will prefer a blessing over you and honor your presence here at this table. We are so graced to be able to have our bishop with us, to have you here. Rejoice and thanks. This is the day the Lord has made, and we are at the party now that we move to the liturgy.
Let us with gladness present an offering of our life and labor to the Lord.
Is anyone who is in need of a gluten-free wafer? Holler and make sure you're welcome.
Please stand as you're able. We continue with the Eucharistic prayer, the Great Thanksgiving. Page 9 in your worship booklets, I think. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing. Come on now. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in Jesus Christ, our Lord, you have received us as your sons and daughters, made us citizens of your kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth.
Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive the sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Amen. Forever and ever. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
the body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Thank you.
like to sing along 324 in your hymnal, Little Lord of Flesh, you sung to 324.
Pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Bring us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Go in peace, be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, indeed honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and always.
Amen.
Thank you.